When one thinks of the Soviet Union, one invariably tends to picture endless breadlines and brutalist architecture. But believe it or not, my friends, in the early 1960s, the Soviets were at the cutting edge of computer technology and were this close to inventing the Internet. When you think about it a little deeper, the USSR and the Internet do seem like a natural fit. Not for freedom of speech, of course, but for data processing. You see, the Soviet Union had a command economy, where the central planners in Moscow had to plan, track, and price every nut, bolt, and bushel across the Union. These 1 million or so bureaucrats also managed a network of over 10 million inspectors, who would visit the USSR's factories and farms as many as 100 times per year. Collectively, Soviet central planning produced over 800 billion documents per year and was quite literally drowning Moscow in paperwork. Early Soviet cybernetics pioneers were quick to figure out that a nationwide computer network would be far more efficient. So, while the US was still figuring out how to get two computers to talk to each other without catching on fire, a Soviet military engineer called Anatoly Kitov had already mapped out a digital nervous system for the sprawling Soviet economy. To be clear, Colonel Kitov's entire science career was a miracle. The communists had initially banned cybernetics, labeling it as pseudoscience and imperialist propaganda, almost as soon as it had appeared in 1948. It was only thanks to his special military access that Kitov was able to learn about and work on cybernetics. It took a few years before the Central Committee could be convinced to reverse its ban. Stalin had to die first. But by 1955, Kitov and others had made the case that computer science was valuable, and so cybernetics was rebranded from pseudoscience to cutting-edge high-tech. New institutes were built across the Soviet Union, and the field developed rapidly. And over the next 5 years, Kitov's books would become foundational material for cyberneticists across the world. In the wake of his newfound fame, Kitov sent a daring letter to Premier Khrushchev detailing his master plan to digitalize the Soviet economy. His idea was simple. He knew the military already had powerful computer centers that sat idle for large parts of the day. Kitov would hook up the civilian economy to these military machines during their downtime to process economic data, saving billions of rubles. Unfortunately, the Red Army's leaders weren't keen on sharing their toys, especially with civilian bean counters. Marshal Rokossovsky, the famous defender of Stalingrad, fiercely opposed Kitov's project and formed a commission to review his proposal. It vetoed Kitov's plan, dismissed him from the military, and even got him kicked out of the Communist Party for good measure. Now, if you want to be less technologically illiterate than Field Marshal Rokossovsky, you'll be happy to learn about our good friends over at boot.dev. If you've ever tried to learn coding and quit because you were bored to tears by dry lectures, then this is exactly what you've been waiting for. Boot.dev takes you from a complete beginner to a back-end software engineer using the most powerful educational tool known to man, video game mechanics. That's right, my friends. They have turned learning Python, SQL, and Go into a full-blown RPG where you earn XP, level up, and collect achievements just by writing real code. I've been trying it out myself to make the SideQuest Beaver RPG we showed in our Beaver video a while ago, and I have to say, the new Training Grounds feature is brilliant. It lets you grind infinite coding challenges to sharpen your skills, which is perfect for building the muscle memory you need to actually get hired. And don't worry about getting stuck on a difficult quest. You have a personal AI companion named Boots, who knows the context of your lessons and nudges you toward the answer without just giving it away. Boot.dev is all about learning to build real projects in an age when everyone just copy-pastes code they don't understand. And when you consider that the median salary for a back-end developer in the US is over $100,000, leveling up this skill tree is a very smart investment. So, stop procrastinating and start your own coding quest by clicking the link in the description and use the promo code SideQuest to get 25% off your entire first year on the annual plan. Now, while Kitov got burned for his idea of a Soviet internet, one of his cybernetics protégés at the Kiev Institute picked up the torch. Viktor Glushkov, a brilliant mathematician, made the easy calculation of avoiding the military entirely. Starting in 1962, he focused his designs on an entirely civilian computer system with over 20,000 production terminals feeding data into 200 regional computer centers across the Soviet Union, which would ultimately converge on Moscow. This project was even more ambitious than Kitov's and would eventually entail the USSR's transition to a paperless electronic economy. This massive undertaking was estimated to cost some 20 billion rubles, more than the Soviets had spent on their nuclear and space programs put together. When the CIA learned of Glushkov's plan, it was absolutely terrified that the USSR would eclipse the West with its economic gains. But the CIA needn't have worried, because Glushkov faced a much more dangerous enemy than American spies – Soviet bureaucrats. As is tradition in Russian history, before you can build the future, you must first survive the politics of the present. And what Glushkov's vision failed to account for was the sprawling network of corruption that had infected every part of the Soviet economy. Factory managers lied about their output to get bonuses, and ministers lied about quotas to keep their heads. An automated, objective computer system that tracked every single screw in real time was an existential threat for every Soviet middle manager. And so, despite tremendous progress in design and technology, Glushkov's project got delayed year after year until it was finally rejected altogether in 1970. Among the various reasons the finance ministry came up with to divert funding from Glushkov's project was to install computer-controlled lighting and music in chicken coops to boost egg production. In the end, all the Soviet ministries had to compete with each other for funding to build out their own computer networks. So, thanks to capitalist-like competition, the Soviet Union ended up with 1,000 incompatible networks, rather than a single Soviet intern yet. Meanwhile, the United States built out their first network, ARPANET, to withstand nuclear attacks, and then let all its universities and agencies hook up to it over time. The irony really is palpable. The capitalists built a communal network, while the socialists were too paranoid to share their data. Glushkov died in 1982, and then, just under a decade later, the Soviet Union followed him into the grave, collapsing exactly as his models had predicted it would without computer modernization. Had OGAS succeeded, we might be living in a very different timeline, perhaps one where the Soviet Union didn't crumble under the weight of its own inefficiency. We'll never know for sure, but we can be certain that somewhere in a parallel universe, there is a Soviet version of SideQuest asking you to like and subscribe. Speaking of which, if you want to help us keep our own little digital node running, please consider supporting us on Patreon so that we can navigate the bureaucratic maze of the YouTube algorithm and keep the lights on in our own little chicken coop. Don't forget to check out boot.dev using the link in the description to start your coding journey. Maybe you can build the network that Glushkov never could. Thanks for watching, and stay tuned for the next algorithmically approved episode of SideQuest. Why did the Soviet computer go to the doctor? Because it had a terminal illness.